Before we begin, let me give you a little bit of an introduction about Chalk Talk. Today's Chalk Talk, our eminent speaker, and a little about Avid as well. NCPA Chalk Talk was conceived to be a series of unique lectures and demonstrations with outstanding figures in the performing arts, literature, criticism, and cinema, offering the most diverse perspectives about ideas and the arts. The idea was to bridge the knowledge gap by offering them a series of unique lectures that make art accessible to the layman. We started NCPA Chalk Talk last year in 2010 with our first Chalk Talk on understanding opera. Since then, we've gone on to conduct Chalk Talks on understanding theater, Sufi music, jazz, bandish, and so on. This Chalk Talk precedes NCPA Jazz Matazz, which is a premier international quality jazz festival being held in Mumbai from October 14th to 16th. It features artists like Steve Turay, one of the world's most foremost trombonists, who's been winning the Reader's Poll for Best Trombonist in Downbeat magazine for the last decade. John Faddis, one of the world's most eminent trumpet players. Louise Hayes, who's been playing jazz since the 1950s. He was a drummer with the legendary Cannonball Adderley and continues to produce a similar sound with the Cannonball Legacy Band. Cedar Walton, another jazz veteran from the 50s, is one of the most respected musicians in the field today, whose compositions have become part of the standard jazz repertoire. His playing regularly receives praise from critics, fellow jazz musicians, and audiences around the world. Carlton Kito, who's a constant figure in the Indian jazz scene, having played with legends like Steve Turay, Kenny Barron, Chico Freeman, and others. Harsha Makalandi and Chrome. Harsha Makalandi is undoubtedly Sri Lanka's finest jazz pianist. Vibrant American group, the Three Ladies of Blues, and Dutch quartet, the Beats Brothers. Today's lecture will be conducted by Mr. Naresh Fernandez, who's the consulting editor at Time Out India. He's also coming out with a book in November called The Taj Mahal Foxtrot, which is the story of jazz in Mumbai between the 30s and the 60s. This lecture has been presented by Avid, which is a school of continuous learning, an ESSA Foundation initiative that conducts comprehensive lifestyle courses and events spanning across culture and heritage, arts, literature, music, dance, theater, interior and architecture, and personal skill development. Delivered by experts from India and abroad, these workshops are a fun mix of theory and practicals that summarize the essence of the Avid experience. Avid has touched the lives of 3,200 passionate learners and continues the endeavor to make learning accessible to all. For more information, visit www.avidedu.in. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Enjoy the lecture today.
Good evening and thanks for coming out. It's lovely to see so many friends in the audience. This lecture is called Following the Albatross, the Jazz Journeys of Teddy Weatherford, who's a figure that nobody's interested in except me and Mr. Sorabji down there. The first thing most people noticed about him were his hands. Teddy Weatherford had enormous hands. In the late 1930s, a Russian bass player named Nikonishan Markovich Inokentki, who of course was known as Innocent Nick, was sitting in with Weatherford at the Taj, and he had this to say about the pianist. Teddy could play for hours without a break. Even with drinks, he could continue one-handed. He had tremendous hands. Teddy Weatherford was a big man. He stood over 6 feet tall. His long arms and wide hands gave him tremendous reach across the expanse of the piano. His large physique was perfectly suited to a style that was in vogue when he was a young man. It was called stride, a powerful rhythmic style of playing the piano. Performers would play arpeggios and walking bass chords with their left hands and use their right hands to explore the melody. In the 1920s, Weatherford was among the early masters of stride. He played the piano with the rhythmic intensity of a drummer, and if you listen to him from behind a curtain, they said, you could think that there were actually two pianists in the room. The gusto with which Weatherford played the piano, combined with his jovial personality, endeared him to fans on four continents. In Paris and Shanghai, in Chicago and Bombay, the fans were entranced by his presence. The enormous span of his arms led some to call him the albatross. Others called him the seagull. In temperament, though, Teddy Weatherford was as restless as a butterfly. And we're lucky he was. He flitted from place to place, causing cross-pollinations whose blooms still flourish around the world, especially in Bombay. So let me stop talking and let's actually listen to Terry Weatherford, listen to him soar. Weatherford sounded like. Over the next 30 minutes or so, I'm not sure how long this is actually going to take, I'm going to attempt to give you an overview of Terry Weatherford's life. But that isn't very easy to do. In the early 1970s, two British jazz geeks called Peter Dark and Ralph Gulliver started to put together what would eventually be the most comprehensive article about the pianist that has yet appeared. It was published in another jazz geek magazine called Storyville. Dark and Gulliver traveled to the US to track down Weatherford's relatives, one of whom was 104 years old when they met him, or so he said. They interviewed his former bandmates in the UK and India and Australia. They spent hours in the newspaper archives. And after all of this effort, they began their article by noting, "Theodore Teddy Weatherford is one of the most fascinating obscure figures in jazz, a legend in his brief career in Chicago, an enigma because the major part of his life was spent far away from the familiar jazz centers of America." This has presented previous researchers, they said, with extraordinary difficulties in finding accurate and reliable information. Press reports are sparse, contemporary magazine articles are few, mainly relying on Weatherford's own stories. And we have discovered, they said, that Teddy Weatherford was himself prone to exaggeration, and we suspect leg pulling of ingenious interviewers. I don't envy them at all. And I can't claim that my research is anywhere as meticulous as theirs is, but I had one advantage, the internet. Since the 1970s, when these two guys started out, databases of newspapers published in Singapore, Chicago, Paris, and many other places have come online. And these have allowed me to track Weatherford through the continents with slightly more precision than Dark and Gulliver were able to. But I've had to rely quite heavily on their accounts because by the time I started to become interested in this about eight or nine years ago, there weren't many people alive who actually had known Teddy Weatherford. Two of them actually have since passed away, the trumpet player Frank Fernand and very recently the saxophonist Mickey Correa. Now I know of only three people alive who actually had met Weatherford. One of them lives in Deolali, one in Delhi, and he's a friend of Mr. Sarabji's, Percy Dias, and this woman. Her name is Bridget Moe. She lives in Houston, Texas, and she turns 85 on Saturday. So let's start at the beginning. Let's go back to the coal mining town of Pocahontas in the American state of Virginia. That's where Weatherford was born in 1903 to a father who was a coal miner. When Weatherford was aged 4, his father was seriously injured in an explosion in a mine. And Weatherford was sent to live with his sister in a town nearby called Bluefield. As a boy, it was apparent that he had a sharp ear for music. And he soon dropped out of school become a full-time musician. He played at the dances, and if they let him in because he was underage, in bars too. By the time he was 19, in 1922, he'd moved to Chicago, the city to which hundreds of thousands of African Americans from the US South were also headed to find work, and also to escape the cruel racial segregation laws that were operational in America at that time. The Chicago to which Teddy Weatherford moved was the Chicago you see in the movies, the city of speakeasies and of Al Capone. And there was music, lots of it. That's of course why the Roaring Twenties were called the Jazz Age. Jazz had recently emerged as a distinctive form, growing out from its roots in the less sophisticated genre of ragtime. In Chicago, Weatherford was immediately snapped up by a prominent band leader named Jimmy Wade to play at a venue called the House That Jack Built. Weatherford's flamboyance propelled the band to instant prominence. Let's listen to a track they made in 1923. It's called Mobile Blues. And for those of us who are familiar with jazz, this still seems pretty rudimentary. And it still has a slightly rough quality to it. Weatherford was the most famous pianist in Chicago 2 years later when another young musician moved to town. You can see him in the middle of this photograph. His name was Earl Hines, and he would become one of the most influential jazz pianists of all time. Local concert organizers tried to set up Earl Hines and Teddy Weatherford as rivals, but when they met, they actually became good friends. Hines later acknowledged that Weatherford was a major influence as he was developing his own style. Towards the end of 1925, Weatherford left Jimmy Wade to join an outfit left by a violinist named Erskine Tate. It was known as the Vendome Theatre Orchestra. And his bandmates here included another emerging talent, a guy named Louis Armstrong, who would go on to become perhaps the most famous musician the world had ever known. Here's a track they recorded in the mid-1920s.
Thank you.
track actually was a bit of exotica. It's called Chinaman Blues, and they were attempting to somehow evoke a sense of the Orient. But the title was strangely prescient. In August 1926, Weatherford took up yet another assignment, this time with the band leader Jack Carter. It would change his life. The Jack Carter Band had just accepted a 10-week engagement at the Plaza Hotel in Shanghai. Weatherford would find Asia so much to his liking, he would return to the US only once after that. Like Bombay, Shanghai was a port city that was vital to Western trade interests. And though it wasn't a colony, sections of it were, for all practical purposes, autonomous units controlled by the British, the Americans, and the French. These sections were where Westerners lived and entertained themselves, quite lavishly, it seems. That's clear from the attractions listed in an edition of a guidebook called All About Shanghai, which was published a few years after Weatherford arrived in that town. It said, Shanghai has its own distinct nightlife, and what a life. When the sun goes in and the lights come out, Shanghai becomes another city, the city of blazing night. The guidebook promised visitors that they would find a city with hundreds of nightclubs and cabarets, bringing over with high hats and low necks, long tails and short knickers, inebriates and slumming Puritans, wine, women, and song, whoopee. Many of the establishments offered the services of wunu, or taxi dancers, women who received tickets from each partner they twirled around on the dance floor. The African-American writer Langston Hughes, who you can see in this picture, visited Shanghai in July 1933, when he was still a bit of a struggler. And he noted that the city seemed to have a weakness for American Negro performers. One of the best loved of them was Teddy Weatherford, who by now was the star attraction at the Canadrome Ballroom, which advertised itself as the rendezvous of Shanghai's elite. It was housed in a cavernous white building that contained a greyhound racing track. Patrons could eat a 14-course dinner, starting with queen olives, moving on to stuffed capon, and ending with coffee, all for $4. Then they could participate in a nightly lottery or move on to watching the dog races in the other part of the complex. Or they could stay on and dance. This is what the Canadrome looked like. It's pretty enormous for a ballroom. Weatherford really came onto his own in Shanghai. His piano playing was captivating, and he really knew how to get the crowd going. He'd crack jokes and tell stories, and they'd be eating out of his hand. The Canadrome, however, did not have a lock on Weatherford's talents. The pianist performed at four clubs each night. We know this from a vivid portrait of 1930s Shanghai written by the trumpet player Buck Clayton. His band, the Harlem Gentlemen, played alongside Weatherford at the Canadrome. This is what the bandstand of the Canadrome looked like. Clayton said in his memoirs that Weatherford could only play with us one number before he would have to leave for another club to be in time for his show there. He would play one half hour at each club, running from one club to the next, but by the end of the week, he'd have four salaries coming to him. Weatherford's signature number at with the Harlem Gentlemen was Rhapsody in Blue, the Gershwin tune. Though jazz was especially popular in Shanghai, the city also enjoyed a spectrum of other sounds. Buck Clayton wrote, there were many bands of different nationalities, Filipino bands, Russian bands, East Indian bands, and of course, Oriental bands. They all played on so many different kinds of instruments. Inevitably, these performers began to slip elements of each other's sounds into their own music. As early as 1929, the American band leader Whitey Smith, who was playing in Shanghai, on the advice of an officer in Chiang Kai-shek's army, had tried to adapt jazz to Chinese tastes. He was so successful in doing so that the management of the ballroom, which was so delighted at having so many new patrons come in, gave him a $5,000 bonus and two first-class tickets to San Francisco for a holiday. Smith and the 36-member Majestic Hotel Orchestra went on to record four Chinese-inflected discs for Victor label with vocals by a Chinese singer.
time with our lips all now so true. In my arms, dear, away from home, dear, we let the rest of the world go by. While the moon shines so brightly, we'll make love when it's nighttime in old Shanghai.
Buck Clayton's band was also performing Chinese-inflected jazz. And some of the tunes that they performed had been composed by a Chinese musician named Li Jinhui, who was deeply influenced by Teddy Weatherford and by Shanghai's other African-American bands. At that time, Weatherford and Buck at the time that Weatherford and Buck Clayton were at the Canidrome, Li put together the first all-Chinese dance band at the Yangtze River Hotel. It was called the Clear Wind Dance Band. Li's critics dismissed his compositions as yellow music, which is the color associated with pornography in China. He was vehemently denounced both by the Kuomintang Republicans on the right and by the radical left. But the condemnation didn't diminish his popularity, and that was evident from the high sales of his records and from the demand for his talents by Chinese film producers. Quite uncannily, Li's innovations in Shanghai, which were inspired in no small part by Teddy Weatherford and his colleagues, foreshadowed by a decade the swing-influenced Hindi film sound that would take India by storm from the 1940s. Here's a track that Li composed, and this is the Canidrome Ballroom, called Pretended Decency. I'm not sure what they were pretending to. Oops. Li Jinhui pretending to decency in decadent Shanghai. As for Weatherford, by the mid-1930s, he was using Shanghai as his base to travel extensively through Southeast Asia. Langston Hughes noted that Weatherford was stopping at Singapore for side trips to the Malaya jungle to play at parties and dances at remote British clubs and rubber plantations in the upcountry. Stiff-necked Britishers and old China hands from Bombay to the Yellow River swore by his music, Langston Hughes said. Teddy could walk into any public place in the Orient and folks would break out into applause. In 1935, when Teddy Weatherford was in the middle of an engagement at Raffles Hotel in Singapore, he was lured away to join a band headed by a trumpet player named Cricket Smith, who you can see on the screen here. Cricket Smith's band had been booked for a season at the Helendoon Hotel in Surabaya, in East Java, in what's now Indonesia. Smith was a short, stocky guy with a mysterious 4-inch scar on the left side of his neck. After his band, which was called the Symphonians, finished their obligations in Java, Cricket Smith took them back to the city that had been their home since 1933, Bombay. Bombay in the mid-1930s was already a fairly global city, and that's obvious from this newsreel, which was made around that time.
Approaching the city of Bombay, the gateway to India. And the first view that comes to our attention is the gate itself, an admirable illustration of Great Britain's constructive influence. Bombay is the second largest city of India and one of the chief seaports of the Orient. It has a mixed population of over 1 million people, representing practically every race and creed in the world. Thank you. Taj Mahal Hotel is unquestionably the most pretentious one in all of India. One of the outstanding features of Bombay is its sudden transitions from the modern to the ancient. This scene, for example, was taken a few minutes from the heart of the city, where the 15th century is constantly rubbing shoulders with the 20th. These automobiles cutting into this line of ancient vehicles suggest an odd symbolism which typifies all of India, for time and time again the new cuts into the old. But the gap is soon filled in, and the ancient procession goes on in strange defiance. At the famous race course in Bombay, we are again transported into another world, for here is gathered representatives of every nationality, creed, and color. The course itself is considered to be the most picturesque, if not the finest in the Orient. We are particularly interested in the costumes worn by the Parsi women. The Parsis are the descendants of exiled Persians. The entire Parsi population now numbers over 50,000, most of whom are residents of Bombay. They are regarded as the wealthiest class in India, and they are obviously the most progressive. Owing to its central position between the east and west, no city can show a greater variety of types than Bombay. Here we find gathered Parsi merchants, Arab traders, Afghans, and Sikhs, Chinese, Japanese, Malayans, Americans, and British, all part of the cosmopolitan crowds so characteristic of Bombay. Not far from...
So the cosmopolitan crowds who gathered in Bombay... were also, in addition to going to the races, eager to consume the latest cultural offerings from around the world. And in 1933, the Taj Mahal Hotel hired the Symphonians from Paris to play dance music. The Symphonians were a large multinational, multiracial band headed by the bespectacled musician, Jos Gisleri. In keeping with the spirit of the times, The Times of India labeled its headline, its article, to welcome them to the city, the modernized, as you can see. Gisleri returned to Paris after a single season at the Taj. So the band, the Symphonians, were taken over by Cricket Smith. Shortly after the Symphonians landed in Bombay in 1933, the Rotary Club published a brochure to attract new business to the city. The introduction was by Bombay's governor, Lord Brabourne, and it boasted that Bombay is known as the gateway of India. This is a geographical fact which has had its influence in making Bombay the most advanced part of the country. Other features that made Bombay attractive to industrialists, Lord Brabourne said, were its state-of-the-art port, efficient transport links with the rest of India, and an airmail service to Europe via Karachi. Within Bombay, there was an excellent electric rail network that would soon touch Virar. In 1934, the BEST extended its bus network to include Mahim at the very edge of the island city. These new communication connections seemed to speed up the very pace of life itself. And as people around the world were discovering, the frenetic rhythms of jazz seemed to perfectly reflect the hyperkinetic tempo of modernity. Excuse me. Because of the Symphonians and the other bands that followed them, Bombay was already pretty familiar with jazz by the time Teddy Weatherford arrived here in the middle of 1936. His reputation had preceded him. The Times of India reported excitedly that Cricket Smith's band had returned from Java with a red-hot pianist who was a wizard of the keyboards. A few months later, Bombay became an even more swinging place when the band of Leon Abbey returned to the Taj. Abbey was a violinist from Minnesota. He had first come to Bombay in 1935, and he'd caused a serious sensation because his outfit was, to use the term prevalent at the time, the first all-Negro band that India had ever seen, in fact. And so his return in 1936 meant that there were more than a dozen African-American musicians in Bombay between his band and the Symphonians. And they often played together at the Taj and at Green's Hotel next door, which is now where the Taj Mahal Tower stands. In addition to playing jazz, Weatherford was part of a quartet that sang Negro spirituals. And when they weren't playing jazz, the musicians were taking the sights in around town. This is a familiar one. And an Orientalist image. I suppose they found it curious too. Leon Abbey didn't make any records in India, but his first band, the Savoy Bearcats, had made its reputation at the Savoy Ballroom in Harlem. They cut many sides, and so we can assume that they played the same kind of music, a mixture of stomp, essentially. It wasn't only Bombay's dancing crowd that was having a whale of a time. Indian musicians whose opportunity to learn about jazz had until then been restricted to listening to music on records finally had the chance to figure out how it was done by some genuine masters. That season, the African-American musicians in Bombay included the saxophonist Rudy Jackson, who had played with Duke Ellington, and also the virtuoso trumpet player Bill Coleman. Bill Coleman left an extensive account of his stay in Bombay in a memoir called Trumpet Story, and he recounts how young Indian musicians would come by to the Taj in the morning to seek advice and ask questions about how to play jazz. Among them was somebody who Mr. Sarabji knew, a young man called Rudy Cotton. The Indian musicians were quick learners. In 1937, Terry Weatherford took over the band at the Taj from Cricket Smith because age had begun to catch up with the trumpet player. And he hired several Indians to play in his band. This is an image from that time. We can see these two brothers, they are Anglo-Indians, Hal Green and Henry Green. And there's also another Indian who's playing the saxophone, Josik Menzies. Josik was actually born Josiko Menezes, but when he walked in, Terry Weatherford, legend has it, couldn't pronounce his name. So he said, it's too much. You drop the O from your name, and instead of Menezes, you call yourself Menzi. So you'll be called Josik Menzi now, not Josiko Menezes. So this is a pretty historic image. It shows the birth of an Indian jazz scene that's still alive today. We'll come back to that in a little while, but now we need to go off on another short journey with Terry Weatherford, this time to Paris. In the summer of 1937, after he'd been in Bombay a year, Weatherford took a holiday in the French capital with a saxophonist named Roy Butler, who was his bandmate. Musicians who met him in Paris remember him as a gregarious man dressed in a white sharkskin suit, a broad white hat, and as a lively, if not always accurate, storyteller. He was always willing to play for an audience, they said. The correspondent for the Chicago Defender was really bowled over. He said, "Terry Weatherford, that formidable pianist, has been hailed as the real thing by our group in Paris. Since his arrival on May 9th, he has been a constant recipient of gay dinner parties, afternoon teas, and cocktails." He added that Terry has brought along his $1,000 piano accordion. "God, that man can play," he said. Paris, which was already the epicenter of several radical artistic and classical music movements, had become the jazziest city outside of the US since the end of the First World War. Harlem-style restaurants and jazz clubs flourished in the shadow of the hill that was crowned by the Sacré-Cœur Basilica. These clubs featured African-American performers as their main attraction. Before Cricket Smith and Leon Abbey came to India, they'd made their reputations in Paris. The First World War wreaked havoc in Europe, but proved strangely liberating for African Americans. The conflict brought approximately 200,000 black troops to the continent. They included the composer James Rhys Europe, under whose baton Cricket Smith had made well-regarded recordings in the US as early as 1913. In the autumn of 1917, as clouds of mustard gas hung over the continent, James Rhys Europe was dispatched to France after he had been given an express command. His commanding officer told him to recruit the best damn band in the United States Army. Whoops, that's them. In response to that, the composer assembled an exceptionally talented brass band that came to be called the Harlem Hellfighters. And they took this name because that was the nickname of the 15th Heavy Foot Infant Regiment to which they were attached. Before they got into the trenches, though, the Harlem Hellfighters extensively toured France. And they left the country with a deep appreciation of a form that in France is still called le jazz hot. For many African-American soldiers, the war was the first exhilarating opportunity to live in a country in which color prejudice seemed almost absent. When they returned home after the war, many African-American troops were appalled by the discrimination they faced again. Several of them went back to Paris, forming a vibrant community that came to be known as Harlem in Montmartre. The African-American expatriates in Paris sparked a frisson that came to be known as Le Tumulte Noir, the Black Commotion. The imagined jungle energy and primitive purity of African-American performers in France profoundly influenced the work of such European painters as Fernand Léger, who painted this painting, which is called Jazz. It wasn't long before France developed its own style of jazz. Crucial to its evolution was the gypsy guitar player Django Reinhardt and the violinist Stéphane Rapelli. Playing alongside such African-American maestros as the saxophonist Benny Carter and trumpet players Cricket Smith, Bill Coleman, and Harry Cooper, the French jazz musicians created a joyous, pliant sound that would soon loop back across the Atlantic and find fans even in the US. Teddy Weatherford's trip to Paris in 1937 was another step forward in the process of jazz acquiring a French accent. And this is Django Reinhardt and Stéphane Rapelli to give you a sense of what they were doing. When he returned to Bombay, Teddy Weatherford was to become the anchor of the city jazz scene, and he taught local musicians such as Frank Fernand and Mickey Correa invaluable lessons. As Frank Ferdinand told me a few years ago, Teddy Weatherford taught him how to play like a Negro. He taught him how to be adventurous in his music, how to improvise, and how to swing. When Weatherford toured other parts of Asia, he took Indian musicians along with him. So the Green Brothers and Josik Menzie, without the O in his name, found themselves sailing to Ceylon and to Java and to Singapore. So this is a picture of the Teddy Weatherford band in Colombo at the Goldface Hotel in the late 1930s. In each of these places, they left a deep impression on local musicians and sowed the seeds for local jazz scenes to develop. Back in Bombay, the Taj put a pear-based dessert on its menu called Poor Glass Weatherford. It was acts like these that kept Weatherford in India for so long. When he asked why he liked the country so much, he had a standard answer. He said, "They treat us white folks fine," acknowledging that he was treated better in India than he'd have been in America. When the Second World War broke out, hundreds of thousands of Allied troops flooded into India. Suddenly there was a demand for dance bands to entertain them. Teddy Weatherford's band at the Taj found itself working overtime. But towards the end of 1941, his wanderlust struck again. As one of his musicians explained, Teddy was a man who couldn't stay long in one place. He left for Calcutta to take up an engagement at the Grand Hotel. The war was felt more intensely in Calcutta than in Bombay because Calcutta was much closer to the front in Burma. In addition to creating a huge demand for jazz bands to play at dances, the war also created a significant Western music recording scene in India, and this is something Mr. Chandmankar knows all about. The conflict resulted in import restrictions, and music records definitely weren't essential commodities. To get around that, HMV began to get local bands to do their own versions of songs that were popular in America, a little like T-Series began to do years later. Weatherford recorded more than 70 sides between November 1941 and June 1944. While some of these discs highlight his solo work, others feature him as an accompanist to visiting musicians, such as Paquita and Zarate, a Latin American couple. The wife was a singer and the husband played the violin. For Indian musicians, though, the pianist recordings with two ensembles, the All-Star Swing Band and Teddy Weatherford and his band, are the most significant. Both feature Indian musicians playing alongside Americans. Weatherford made at least 8 sides with the All-Star Swing Band, whose members included an Anglo-Burmese guitar player named Cedric West, the Goan bassist Tony Gonsalves, and the Nepalese trumpet player George Banks, whose son Louis Banks is probably the most famous Indian musician today, Indian jazz musician today. West, Gonsalves, and Banks were also included on nearly 24 other discs Weatherford made with an outfit called Weatherford and his band. And that outfit was augmented on some occasions by a Parsi who had been born Kavasji Kadao, but who some people in this room remember as Rudy Cotton, and also by the Anglo-Indian trumpet players Bill McDermott and Pat Blake. Despite the frequency with which Weatherford went into the studio, though, his numerous recordings turned out to be a beguiling deception for contemporary jazz fans. The bulk of Weatherford's work was actually popular standards aimed at a local market starved for records. For the most, these records give only a hint of the jazz talents of the pianist and his Indian sidemen, but there's little to conclusively prove their prowess. But even with these limitations in mind, Weatherford's recordings remain a keen matter of discussion where other jazz geeks like me hang out on the internet. And all these years later, people are still discussing these recordings because the pianist, as I said, returned to America only once after he'd left for China in 1926. And so while tales about his scorching performances at the Tate Vendome Orchestra in Chicago had become the stuff of legend, his Indian sides and a couple of things he met in Paris are the only corroborative evidence of his talent, however tangentially. Very few of these recordings have actually made their way officially to CD, so this has just fed Teddy Weatherford's mystique. That said, he did make some pretty swinging records, and there's this one called Ice Cold Katie, which is sung by this woman.
Thank you.
beautiful woman, one of the three people I said was still alive who had played with Teddy Weatherford. This is her now. I'm going to go off on a tangent, but she contacted her granddaughter, who we saw in the first picture, contacted Suresh Chandmankar of the Society of Indian Record Collectors a couple of weeks ago. She tracked him down on the internet and said that she was trying to plan a surprise for her grandmother's 85th birthday. Her grandmother had married a Hawaiian musician who was in Calcutta at the time and gone back to Hawaii. And that's another completely different loop. And since she'd gone back, they didn't have any of their grandmother's recordings. So they asked Mr. Chandmankar whether there were any available in India. And as it turns out, there was that one. So this is Bridget Moye with her great-grandkids, who I've been told in this picture are teaching her how to rap like gangsters. Evidently, this is some sort of gangster sign. But back to Bombay, or Calcutta, where we left Teddy Weatherford. One winter evening, on his way back from a reporting trip to China to cover the war, a journalist for the Bombay Chronicle named Dosu Karaka ran into Weatherford at the Grand Hotel in Calcutta. The pianist greeted Karaka with his characteristic effusiveness, shaking his hand until Karaka said it nearly came loose at the joints. Weatherford told Karaka that he'd recently got married. But this was an uncertain time for African-American musicians in India. As the Japanese moved closer to the Indian border, many of them who had made India their home since the 1930s decided to leave. They were offered free passages out on troop ships. But Weatherford was among those who chose to stay. He just acquired a wife, of course, and he'd lived in India for 10 years. A few months later, in May 1945, a cholera epidemic swept Calcutta, claiming an average of 70 victims a day. Teddy Weatherford was among the first to die. He died in the Presidency General Hospital, aged only 43. As his casket was carried to the Lower Circular Road Cemetery, an estimated 40,000 people lined the streets to pay their respects. Teddy Weatherford was buried, and a gravestone was put on that read, "In loving memory of Teddy Weatherford, died April 25th, 1945, a wonderful pianist and a friend. May his soul rest in peace." Teddy Weatherford's death marked the end of an era and the beginning of a new one. That was evident from the announcement of his death in the American jazz magazine Downbeat. It carried a headline on the front page saying, "Former Buddy Tate 88er dies in Calcutta." But the top of the page was dominated by a photograph of somebody they described as a mad trumpet man whose frantic horn has been the talk of the big town, and carried a picture of the smiling Dizzy Gillespie. As swing was being swept out by the frenetic new style of bebop in the US, jazz in India was also changing. India's jazz musicians had now acquired a great deal of proficiency. One American writer who heard Rudy Cotton playing in Delhi with Frank Fernand in the front row noted that